Well, guys, welcome to the Totally Awesome Fishing Show. We're here at Lake X. Secret X. One. Fingers crossed we're going to catch something. We're going to be using highly technical bait. Yes.
Bread.
That's all we're going to go with. I have got a can of sweet corn in the car. We're going to try and see what we can catch with £2.85 worth of supermarket bait. Mike, you're on what?
I'm using probably the most simple method out there. Literally, line, rod, reel. It goes straight through all the way to a, well, I'm using a size 4 hook today, and I'm just going to put on, I'm basically targeting the fish up on the surface, so I'm just putting a chunk of bread on, keeping it really simple.
They look twitchy, there's a few bits of freebies we've thrown in.
Yeah.
A little bit spooky, but it might be early, because this place is apparently not hammered at all, you know. Having said that, you could call it Death Valley instead of Lake X, going by the number of leads that are up in the high power electrical cables over the top.
Yeah.
I like collecting leads, guys. I'm not collecting those ones, trust me. I'm going to be using a trusty Avon float, which is a bit bizarre. I know you think, why is he not using a Waggler? And that's because that one was the first one out the box. I'm going to be ground baiting closer in. Oh, hello. I'm going to be ground baiting closer in. Mike's going to be just wandering around, sort of stalking, aren't you?
So really? We're doing two completely different tactics. I'm looking for the fish up on the surface. That's looking for the fish down on the bottom.
Bigger ones.
Bigger ones, maybe, who knows? But what we've done is we've done a kind of recce. We've walked around the lake, we've chucked out some freebies, bits of bread. Dad's chucked out some small Skretting 2mm pellets.
Yeah.
Just to gauge where the fish are. And we found an area of the lake where they seem to be rising the most, don't they? The most activity is down in this corner.
Around this little island and bushes and overhangs.
Yeah, in a jungly area, I'm going to do a bit of stalking in there. It's not really stalking rod, but I can do, if I keep the line right close to the rod tip, I should be okay.
And if I don't catch on the float, trust me, I will be stalking as well. Let's get out and see if we can't catch something for you.
Fish on Secret Lake X. And it looks like a nice scaly mirror. And I stalked this one right in the margins to the on the overhangs on my right. Come on, mate.
He's bigger than you think. You thought he's 2 pounds. He's bigger than that.
Yeah.
He's not 2 pounds.
Still got gas in him. Let's try and weave him out. There we go, in the net. First fish of a brand new lake. Let's take a look at him. That is pretty lovely scales on
that's
that.
That's not bad, is it? I've seen
big scales as well.
I've seen worse ones for sure.
Yeah, that's a lovely fish. Nice tail on it. I don't know about you, I don't know if it's one of the Polaroids I've got on, but polarising glasses, but the colours on it look really nice, almost like autumn colours from where I am.
Yeah, it does look golden belly, doesn't it? I'm just zooming in on those scales, got lovely markings on the scales there.
Yeah, really nice fish. Put up a good scrap, caught in the margins. Saves the blank.
The first fish from Lake X. Okay, so I'm fishing literally just down there, maybe a rod length out. Going to use a piece of bread flake. Now, I've plumbed the depth. That's important on new waters we've never been in before, is to plumb the depth. I've plumbed the depth, which is a weight that pulls the float under, and you keep sliding the float up until it's just what we call dead depth. It's just resting on the bottom. I'm going to use a piece of bread flake. I'm going to put it around the hook like this, and then all you do is just pinch the back end around the eye of the hook, not the point, otherwise it goes really gobby and slimy and you'll strike and you'll miss the fish. Now that's the way to do that. You can see I've just pinched it flat there. I'm going to swing it out. I've ground baited down here. Mike's working around the island and the bushes the other side. And this is my first cast going out on Lake X, and it's a bad one I've tangled up. There you are. Try again. I want to go past the swim, and I reckon about there where that float settled. I'm going to check the drag because we don't know what's in this lake. It's an unknown quantity, this one. The float, I don't know if you can pick that up there. There's a fish just picked a piece of loose crust off the surface. Oh! It's only a small fish, but look. Not bothered by that big hook at all. Pretty little carp. Now imagine if you came here with maggots, you could really get them going. I don't know, we've not done it before. But that's a nice little carp there. First cast, that can't be bad. It's a Lake X carp for me. Right, what I'm bailing in here, about sort of golf ball size, is a mixture of about 20% bran and 80% of that Bailey's horse feed, and I get it fairly damp and sloppy. That's why I'm taking one of Mike's bit of bread. I'm just basically barely squeezing that together, because the Bailey's feed does go quite gluey. And bingo, what I'm doing is, you can't see it from where you are, but where I am, there's a shadow line from this island tree there. So I'm hoping that's going to give me some form of accuracy. And I really am fishing just down to the left of a feather that's floating there, about there or thereabouts. So Mike's going a bit further out. I'm going to spray it around there. And because the water's coloured, a lot of waters, to find out if they've got carp in them of any numbers, if it's coloured generally, it's a good head of carp in there. I mean, that's what we've been told. That's why we've come nearly 2 hours in traffic to get here to give it a go. First cast out of the way, I feel another piece of bread coming. Okay, the float I've got has got a float rubber at the top, and then the line goes through the rings at the bottom. You can have a float rubber there as well, but I'm only fishing in the margin, so there's no reason why I can't just use a regular float, old school. I'm fishing like a child, really. Well, I am very childlike when you think about it. 3 BB shot there, okay. And then I've got a smaller shot there just to anchor it. Now that one I can move up and down should I so wish, like this. If I want to rest that on the bottom, you see that little shot there, that will rest and just anchor, and I've basically got that shot. I want it off the bottom like this, but if it starts to get breezy, which it is now with the ripple, I like to anchor my bait a little bit, stop the float dragging, and that little shot there just resting there will stop that, hopefully. Second cast coming, guys. I like doing this because that way Mike's not fishing, he's on the camera. I've got more chance of catching something. There we go. Now it's just waiting for that float to settle. I can't imagine it'd be too long before they come. Got my drag set. That was a bite then. There's a bite. Oh, I missed him. How could I miss that float? Oh my God, it just shot under. Tell you what I'm going to do. Being of the size of carp I just caught just now, a small, I'm going to get my baits smaller, a little bit smaller bait, and then if I miss another one or two, let's move that shot a tad, I'm going to start going to a smaller hook, 10 or something like that. Fish are obviously on that ground bait. I thought they would move in because the water is so coloured. Let's just watch that float, got to concentrate. Don't need a huge strike. Missed it again. I think there's some small carp down there. Now the other thing, guys, just I'll tell you what, I'm sorting this immense tangle out. Oh, it's out. You can also get line bites, and that tells you there's a lot of fish in the swim. And basically, they're all rooting and digging around on the ground bait, and they got what we call a line bite. They're bumping the line. So what I'm going to do next time is let that float hold under a little bit longer, because that, to me, I should have had two fish in two casts there. And I've got a feeling there might be a lot of fish feeding down there. So let's just let that float sail away and stay under. Bit of a pause is what we need. Now you can see there, my float's dragged to the right. There we go, just that pause. Ah, exactly right. My God, how do I live with myself? I mentioned about the small carp. That was exactly what they were. They're digging and rooting around. Little small baby carp there. Only weensy. But you can see what I was getting were line bites. As soon as I scaled down my bait size, I caught the fish. So if you're kids out there, maybe start with the big bait, and if you're getting bumps and bangs and floats and bites and dips that are missing, scale that bait down. About time you went fishing, Mike. I think that's 3-1. Nearly. Look at the little dips on that float, guys. Oh, that's why I like float fishing. They could be liners. Not quite pulled the float under. Oh, I missed him. I can't believe it. I'm going to have to go smaller again. Smaller piece of bread flake on this time. Oh, a little dip. Small fish, that tells me. Just move my shot a little bit. Now you can see the ripple is moving, trying to move the float to the right, but that single small shot is holding it in position. There's the lift bite. If you saw the float lift up then, that's a lift bite. I'm waiting for it to sail away and go under the water. There we go. There are the fish on. That's a bit bigger. Oh, that's a bit bigger. That's a bit bigger. Not a lot, but look, at the end of the day, this is fun fishing. I'm going to swing that one. Now you can see how long I had to wait, guys. Let that float dither. It's quite fascinating with float fishing, you know. You're just watching the different types of bite. Little lift bites. They're bumping it, but you've got to keep the rod in your hand. Again, not a big fish. What we call, I suppose you call it farm pond fish. A matchman would love these.
Well, guys, I've noticed, I've had a few fish off the surface, but I've actually noticed as I've gone around the lake, because I don't like to target one area all the time, there's quite a bit of fish activity over in what I'm going to call the jungle area of the lake, where there's really lots of snags. It's very shallow, it's only 2 to 3 feet deep, and there's just lots of overhangs and basically fish holding areas. So what I'm going to do is going to do a bit of stalking, but I've got to keep low profile and really kind of sneak up on them, because they will spot me quite easily. They are near the surface. It's just over behind me here. And I'm going to use that single bit of bread, pinched on nice and tight, and just literally lower it down on them. Well, there we go, jungle fishing at its best. Stalking right in close, didn't have to cast out, just a few freebies of bread, small hook bait, and the fish was caught. Great fun. Get out there and do it, guys.
Okay, so I've had about, I don't know, 25, 30 fish. Those small ones are definitely on the bottom, they're feeding. I cannot get through to the big ones. Mike's getting the bigger ones. He's on the top. Now, if you were float fishing and wanted to make the change, all you've got to do is put the float, what we call bottom end only. I've taken it out from the rubber at the top. I've got all of the shot bolts around the float there, and I've got maybe 2 feet of line. So you cast out, the crust is on the surface, because a lot of guys have trouble knowing when to strike with bread on the top. Whereas this way, if a fish takes on the surface, you don't have to worry if your eyesight's not so great, because you watch the float. If it doesn't go straight under, it'll go sideways like this. As soon as you get that sideways dart, set the hook. So I'm going to give it a go. Look, I know it works, I've done it for years. I'm just trying to give youngsters a few tips to make that change. That's how you catch the extra fish. I've noted Mike's getting a better fish on the crust, on the top. Obviously we can strike straight through on crust, but I'm just saying, I've got a float rod. Rather than break it all down, all I've done is just put it bottom end only. there's my crust. Crust is going to sit on the surface. Float's going to sit there. It doesn't matter if it drifts close or if it drifts away. I can let this swing around in the cut. I can still, if I can't even see the crust, I can still see the float. Another little totally awesome tip for you. Look, it's not as efficient as not having a float at all. I like the fact that I've got the hook and no float, but tell you what, guys, there you go. That's got me into an area and held it in the wind. The weight of the float helped hold it in the wind. And just check out, that is a chunky, fat one. Sneaked him out from the jungle swim just around where Mike had his other ones. A lovely fat one across the back like that. Look, it's not a monstrous, just fun carp that most guys catch. It's the average carp most of you guys out there catch. We don't do specimen hunting, we don't have time for it. We just want to go fishing, we want to catch fish. Here's a place we've never been to before, and we come up with stuff like this. On £2.85's worth of bread.
Well, what we've started to notice this is that basically at this end of the lake, there's actually, as the sun's moving around, we're still early spring, so it's still a fairly low sun. We're getting a big shadow line that's thrown out by this willow tree over here. The willow's actually leafing quite well now. It's got good branches on, it's quite thick. So it's thrown this big shadow down here, and now we're starting to see a bit more carp activity further over in the middle of the lake and towards the other side. And that's probably because it's early spring, the water temperatures are still pretty cold. It's not like summer where that sun punches the heat into that water and warms it right up and it brings the carp up to the surface. So the water's still fairly cold, but they're going to try and cling to that bit of heat. That's what carp enjoy. We're getting near the time where carp do start feeding. So they're going to try and go to the areas that are warmest in the lake. And that is, at the moment, where the sun is, which is further over to our to the other side and in the middle of the lake. So we're going to give it a go over there. And it just changes things up a bit and helps us to basically target more individual fish. So there's two different ways I use the bread. Here's the end crust, which is kind of the well-baked part of the bread. Here's just a normal part of the bread with obviously the crust around the outside. Here on TA Fishing, myself and Dad, we like to bait up, so the ground bait, the freebies that we throw out there, with the soft white part of the bread. So, and you can do this either way. You can either just peel the crust off like that, but leave a bit on the crust because you want to use that as well. But you can either just pinch it out. And then what I do is I break it up into small bits, even smaller than that sometimes, because to get them feeding competitively to begin with, you want lots of small bits of bait. If I chopped out a bit like that, then one carp would get that and all the others would be looking for food. So you want to throw out quite a few small bits. So I'll just chuck this out and you'll watch as it lands on the water, it just scatters everywhere. So this is the crust part. Now I've thrown out the freebies here. I still keep this because I can use these parts as hook baits as well, but for my actual hook bait, this is just a size 4 hook there. I'm just going to peel off a bit, and you can use scissors. You can pre-do this at home and cut out squares, loads of squares, and that way when you come out fishing, you don't waste your time doing what I'm doing now, and you maximise the amount of time you're going to get fish. Pull off a bit about that big, and I like to go soft part first into the hard crust, roll it through, pull it up a bit, turn it, and go back through the crust. This is just a personal thing, guys. We all have our own way of doing it. Then roll it back down, and then any loose bit, just pinch around the hook there, and then that hook point is just showing, and I pinch it around the hook eye, leaving that bit fluffy, and that'll expand in the water. And that's ready to go. Give it one dunk in the water before you cast, and then throw out gently. It's more of a toss. If you whip cast, the bread comes off straight away. You have to toss it out. The other thing, when it's sunny, not so much now when it's spring, but just generally in the late spring and certainly summer, you can tell your bread can get toasted. It can toast out in the warmth and the heat and in the sunlight, it can toast. And when it goes hard and crusty, it will just crumble apart on the hook. So best things to do is make sure if you're out on a hot day, is try and keep this cool, either in a bag, certainly in the shade, or what I do is I carry my unhooking mat like this with me, tuck it under my unhooking mat. That way I know exactly where my bread is and it keeps it in the shade. Well, guys, we're not catching huge carp, but then we're not specimen hunters. We don't go for monster carp. It's nice when they come along, but we're just here for the everyday fishermen, really, on TA Fishing. This is a nice little common, pretty fin perfect. Hopefully got a lot of growing to do, and actually I find commons always put up a bit more of a scrap than the mirrors. And we've noticed the fish are moving out towards the middle of the lake now. They're getting a bit lethargic. It's middle of the day. It's not quite sort of bite time, as we would call it, which we like to think in the summer goes from about 5 to 7pm. Okay, possibly the last fish of the day, we don't know yet. We're going to give a couple more casts, but this is just a small mirror. We've had, the bites have been slower, the sun's starting to go down and the wind's also picked up, so it's making surface fishing quite difficult for me anyway. But I'll give it a crack, see if we can winkle up a few more fish, and then we've got to try and beat the traffic on the way home.
Look forward to it.
Closeout fish. Well, might get a closeout fish, you know, it's like a totally awesome. There's another closeout carp. I'm not sure, that's not the biggest one of the day. It's not a massive lump. I don't think it's, we've seen anything bigger, we really, not in here.
Not massive, massive, but no, still no, nice, you know, nice fish.
Probably
good fighters.
Get double figures, but good scrappers. Cannot fault that. And that one I went to Mike's method, just a straight hook, straight bread. And I think that really must be last but one cast of the day.